We are joined with Mainak Dhar, who's a very senior professional. He's been with Procter & Gamble in India and abroad for a total of 18 years, of which 15 were in APAC and 3 in India. And now he's managing director for General Mills in India. Mainak also is a very successful author, and he has quite a few best-selling books to his credit. Mainak, welcome to Litfest X.
Thank you so much, Kumar. Thanks for this opportunity. It's great to be here.
Yeah. So, Mainak, today, you know, it's very rare to get, you know, swashbuckling CEOs like you on a literary platform. And I'm going to take this opportunity to understand more how you're, you know, balancing, you know, the balance sheet, as well as churning out bestsellers.
Well, I don't know about the swashbuckling part, but I guess a lot of it, Kumar, has to do with long before I was working in the corporate world and doing the jobs I do. Writing was something that was really important to me. Even when I was a child, that's something which I wanted to do. Maybe because I moved around a lot, my father was in the government. So, you know, by the time I finished my education, I'd been to 9 different schools. So ever since I was a little kid, I loved making up stories. You know, when I was in class 7 and 8, I had an imaginary friend who'd sit next to me in class. Once I wrote an account of how the world ended and buried it in my front yard, hoping to mess with the minds of historians who'd find it 1,000 years later. So, you know, I just loved making up stories ever since I was a child. And obviously, you know, then I got my education, started working. But I think when something is as important a part of you as writing is for me, you do try and find a way of fitting it in. And that's how I've been able to sustain it.
You know, one aspect, like you mentioned, Mainak, is, you know, being creative or having an imagination to write. The other aspect is mm-hmm. finding time. Like you mentioned, you know, if you're passionate about it, you're making time. But on the third side is, you know, in your role as a senior business executive, you know, managing a large organization, managing finances and everything else that goes along with it, how does one switch on and switch off this creative imaginary streak? Because you're not in a creative mm-hmm. field professionally. You know, you're not, let's say, making ad films or movies or, you know, writing copy in your day job, so to say. So how do you switch on and switch off?
Actually, it's an interesting question, Kumar. I'll tell you my belief about that. I think the first thing, as you said, is imagination only gets you so far. You need discipline. And exactly. I think that's true for any hobby, you know, whether somebody wants to run marathons, become a great golfer, learn tennis or writing, you need to have discipline. You can't wake up one day and say, I want to go run a marathon. So what I do is, for me, discipline starts with being clear on priorities. So my number one priority is my family. I'm married. We have an 8-year-old son. My second priority is my commitments at work. And then, of course, I want to create some time for myself, my hobbies, my passions. So how over time I've managed to fit in writing into my schedule is every morning I run for about an hour. So then I'm not at work. That's really my thinking time. That's when I'm thinking of stories, thinking of plots. And I try and write half an hour a day. What I've realized is, you know, if I say I'm going to write 3 hours in a particular day, it's never going to be sustainable. I try and write half an hour every day. And normally when I'm traveling on work, I get a lot of writing done. So if you imagine you're on a flight or sitting in a hotel room in the evening, I get a lot of writing done. So that's how over time I've been able to find the equilibrium. Now, to your point on switching on and off, I actually have a slightly different point of view, because I think when you're running a business, and you know, in a consumer focused business of the sort I work in, where it's all about innovation, it's all about connecting with consumers, it's about inspiring employees, it's about, you know, getting and motivating employees. For me, Apple combines my day job and my night job, which is the ability to tell stories. So if you think of it, the best brands are built where you can tell stories about them. You really motivate employees not by just giving them a designation. You motivate employees by inspiring them, by showing them what's possible in the future, by telling them a story of what could happen if they really went along a certain path. So for me, I see it as less of switching on. I think both sides of my life add value to each other. The creative writing side of my life, I think, allows me to make connections, tell those stories, articulate myself in a way that hopefully resonates with people emotionally. And I think the business side of my life really feeds my writing in two important ways. One, I think it's really taught me the importance of discipline, because when you're managing multiple priorities, when you're managing multiple projects, you have to be disciplined. And that's something I take to my writing. And the second very rich aspect which I take away from my day job is understanding people. I think at the core of, you know, my job today is understanding what motivates people, understanding what doesn't motivate people, understanding how different people can come together, operate under stress, work together. And I think that understanding of people is something which I really do also take into my writing.
Very interestingly, you mentioned that you're able to find the common path in the Venn diagram, so to say, between imagination, creativity, and inspiration, which is driving you to write your books, as well as what you do on a day-to-day business basis within the organization. Have you found ever that whilst you're doing this, one is leading to phenomenal ideas for the other?
It does, certainly. So, if I take a very real life context of, just over the last 2 years that I've been with General Mills in India, one of our big tasks was how do we really motivate the organization, set it up for explosive growth. And as we talk to a lot of our employees, especially our younger employees, the feedback was they really want to be entrepreneurial. If you think of people who are joining startups today, they really want to, try out things, take risks. At the same time, they want to benefit from the fact that you're part of a big multinational. And so how do you really find the intersection, as it were? Part of it is very emotional, part of it is very rational. And the interesting thing which you mentioned, how we went about the journey, is we said, look, you're not going to solve this by making PowerPoints. You really need to think of this as, look, what's the rallying cry? What's the story we're going to tell people that's going to help them succeed? And through that process, we came up with what we almost think of as a tagline for our organization, which is win with the mind of a multinational in the heart of a startup. And that resonated really well with the organization, allied to it, which is how do we take advantage of our global scale and yet be entrepreneurial, take risks. This year, we, for the first time, made it on the Great Place to Work Institute's list of top employers in India. And I think this was an example of thinking about it as a storytelling challenge rather than slides into a town hall. Really helped me and my team think of it a bit differently than we might have, which is if you had, what's the hook of your novel? They almost tell you what's your elevator pitch. And so we almost took it as, if I have to explain what this organization is going to be in an elevator pitch, what would it be? I don't have a PowerPoint slide. I have to express it simply in a way that resonates with the heart and mind. So that's one very recent example that I can think of where the writing and creative side, and not so much the side, but the way of thinking, has helped me at work. And on the flip side, I think the biggest benefit my corporate experience has led to my writing career is really that sense of discipline, which is, when I meet a lot of young folks, especially who say, I want to write a book. It's, it's not easy to write a book by any means. Writing a novel itself requires a lot of dedication, but it's even tougher to sustain it. And I think some simple tools, so this may sound really geeky, but when I'm working on a book, I have an Excel sheet where I'm tracking how much have I written every day. And am I above target or below target? And, it's just simple tools, because I think that's what corporations use to keep themselves disciplined. That's how big businesses are built, because you do the same thing over and over. And you know what? In 9 or 12 months, you actually have a draft of a novel written. And I think that's that discipline, that, focus on the small steps. If you repeat them with consistency, you will get big results. I think that's some of the discipline which I've really learned from my day job, which I try and adopt to my writing.
Very, very interesting insights, Menak. I want to shift gears very briefly to your latest book, 0302. And tell us very briefly about it. And, how did you come about that subject?
No, absolutely. So 0302 is a thriller set in Mumbai. And the whole premise is at 0302 in the morning, The whole world goes black. There's no electricity, there's no internet, there's no phone, and it's a normal middle class neighborhood trying to deal with a world where suddenly you're cut off from all information, cut off from all communication, you're reliant on yourself for your safety. And then gradually these people realize that it's not an act of nature, but it's actually a terror attack. And there are terrorists sweeping through our city, our country. If you imagine what we read about happening in Iraq or Syria, that's starting to happen here. And then how do these people, normal middle class people, you know, people who are not superheroes or soldiers, people like you and me, how do we react? How do we come together? How do we fight back? And I think the inspiration for this was really born out of two sources. One is, of course, the world we live in. Unfortunately, we live in a world where such things happen all too frequently, very tragically. And what has always struck me is for a lot of us, we deal with it very vicariously. When something happens somewhere, we'll go on Facebook, we'll change our profile picture, we'll maybe post something, and then we log off and we forget about it. Because we always assume it's somebody else's problem. You know, the police will deal with it, the army will deal with it. What would happen if we actually had to deal with it? And I'd like to believe that, and that's where the hopeful part of the story is, that we as Indians can rally together, forget our superficial differences, and then really stand together. And I think the second part of the inspiration, I think, comes more from personal experience. So, you know, while the story portrays fictional insurgents in a way, you know, Indians fighting on home ground against an invader, I had the privilege of knowing an individual who belonged to a generation of Indians who actually did that in real life, which was my grandfather. He was a freedom fighter during the British rule. And so he used to tell me a lot of stories about what that time was like when, as a young man, they would actually go and use their superior understanding of local terrain, local languages, local people, to really wage asymmetrical warfare, in a, to use modern terms, against a much more powerful force. And after independence, he actually became part of the first batch of Free India's IPS officers. So he had a remarkable ability to say, I was an insurgent and now I'm part of the establishment. So I think a lot of the insights he gave about how at one time Indians, young Indians, did make great sacrifices for our country and united to fight together. And that those really are the two inspirations that went behind this novel.
That's very interesting when you mention that, you know, the cast in the book, you're saying, is, well, ordinary Indians. So, you know, and India has, you know, had and continues to have, you know, long sort of relationship with terror, whether homegrown or, you know, external. And we've seen different kind of responses from society, from media, you know, whether it was 26, you know, 11. And so there have been different responses. What have you emulated in the book in terms of the responses which should ideally be there, or which you think can really be expected from citizens in India?
The positives which I have spotted, which I have tried to build into the novel, is, I think, for all our differences, when tragedy strikes, if you think of the floods in Chennai last year, even 26/11, I think there is an inherent sense of community and patriotism. People do try and help each other. People do genuinely open up their homes, go and support each other. And I think that's something which is a deep undercurrent. You know, when stuff happens, of course there will be somebody who tries to divide it. By and large, we come together. And that's one of the big messages which I try to play out, is if, God forbid, something like this happens, I think the one instinct we need to rely on is that ability to come together, put our differences aside, and then really work together. And that's something which gives me a lot of hope for India, honestly, as I think of, you know, a lot of people say India's got so many issues, so many differences. What gives me heart, despite all those differences, we are a functioning democracy. You can voice what you want. I mean, if you talk about our tolerance for diversity, we have thousands of years of history which says that we assimilate more than we reject, which gives me a lot of hope that we are going to be able to come together as a people. I think the thing that plays out in the book as well, the message I'm really trying to play out is, you know, we shouldn't always wait for someone else to solve our problems. And that's where, you know, I'll take a leaf out of what's been seen in some parts of the West. If you think after 9/11, there has not been a single successful hijacking. or a terror plot on an airplane. And it's not that people haven't tried. You know, there are examples like the underwear bomber, the shoe bomber, and others. But in all those cases, what happened is normal, ordinary passengers were alert. They alerted the crew, pretty people. You know, there was a foiled bomb attack in Times Square a few years ago. Again, some guy who was, I think, running a hot dog kiosk saw a suspicious car and he alerted the police. So the message is not that every single one of us now needs to become a superhero and fight terrorists in battle, but it's all about how can we take more charge of our own security, be more alert, help each other out. Because the one thing I do spot is sometimes we are passive. We wait for people to solve our problems. And I think it's a joint responsibility. Of course, the government has its responsibility, but each of us as citizens, responsibility for safeguarding our freedom, being more alert, being more aware. And that's, I think, the second part which I'm really trying to bring out in the book.
Interestingly, your book, whilst being a thriller, is at the heart of it is also giving a message because of the, you know, projected behavior of citizens. So do you think this is sort of a new genre, you know, an inspirational thriller?
All books, whether thrillers or not, should give a message, and it need not be a preaching kind of message. It could be a message delivered through an entertaining storyline. But I think what I like are both reading as well as writing books, which at the end of it, of course, entertain the reader. I hope the reader loves the book, enjoys the action, but at the end of it is left thinking that, hey, maybe I should think about things differently. Maybe there are a couple of things I could do differently. And I think that's really, for me, what a successful author should always try and do, which is entertain, but at the same time provoke, stimulate.
So reading that can lead to some thinking. Hello, can you hear me?
I'm sorry, Mark, could you repeat that question? I lost
No,
the last few
yeah. So I
seconds.
said essentially reading that can lead to some thinking.
Absolutely, absolutely.
What are you working on next, Mainak? Because you know, I remember you had mentioned that, you know, once your books are done, then very soon you start working on the next one.
No, absolutely. So I think, as I think about the two odd streams in which I've written, so I've had two books come out this year. One is Brandshastra, one is 0302. And Brandshastra really talks about how can you use principles normally used in the corporate world in marketing to impact everyday life. And 03 just talked about is how ordinary people could rise to the occasion, make a difference to the world around them. I think over the next couple of years, I do plan to keep exploring both these directions. As of now, haven't started work on a new book. At the back of my mind, there is a thought that, you know, should I do a sequel for 0302? As you see, the ending, you know, the battle is won, but the war is far from over. So that's something which I'm considering. A couple of readers have written in saying, "Hey, are you cool?" And so that's something which is going through my mind, that do I investigate this world I've created further, see what happens next. But yeah, right now still very much at an ideation stage.
Great. Well, we wish you all the success in the next one and all your future books, Mainak, and may you keep balancing you know, both these parts of life very well and excelling at them. And thank you so much for joining LitFestX and spending time with us.
No, thank you so much for having me here. It's been wonderful. Thanks.